Shalom everyone, this is Amir Tsarfati and I am live from the Judean Hills, right about 10, probably less than 10 miles away from Jerusalem's Garden Tomb, where there is an empty tomb right now. But I would like to invite you to see a replica of that tomb that is right behind me. And I want you to try and sense and feel and understand a little bit of what it was 2,000 years ago for someone that was laid right there inside, and that rolling stone was just blocking and sealing this whole thing, and he's all by himself. So take a look at this. This is a 10-inch thick stone, and it is round, and there is a groove here that it can be rolled all the way back, but as you can clearly see, it is really hard to move this thing by yourself. It is impossible to move it from the inside. It is absolutely impossible to move it from the outside when there's two Roman guards on these two sides. And I would like to tell you something, folks. Being inside, this is really cold right now. We're in this Passover season. But inside, it's even colder. It's cold. It is very lonely. And I would say it is hopeless. Everything inside the tomb was completely hopeless when it remained in the tomb. This whole thing might give you an understanding of the importance and the magnitude of when that rolling stone moved all the way in that resurrection took place. In a few hours, across the world, Christians are going to celebrate the resurrection. They're going to mark the single most important event in the entire gospel that played along 2,000 years ago, as Jesus, Yeshua, came to fulfill all of the spring festivals, Passover, first fruits, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, of course, before that, and later on the Holy Spirit came on the Feast of Pentecost. So here we are on the message that is called the First Fruit Resurrection. And it is obviously something that is hinting of the amazing fulfillment of the Old Testament festivals as prescribed in Leviticus chapter 23. In fact, there is no such thing as Easter in the Bible. There is no such thing as bunnies or egg hunting in the scriptures. We know that as a Jew coming from the line of the tribe of Judah, being here either in Galilee or in Jerusalem, speaking mostly to the Jewish people, Jesus came and fulfilled all that was spoken about him. And of course, it is interesting because in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we read in verse 20 to 23, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. But each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards those who are at his coming. I would like to start with a prayer, and then we'll dive into this message. Father, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you for this unbelievable, life-changing, world-changing, history-making, and death-defeating event that took place 2,000 years ago, less than 10 miles away from where I'm sitting right now. The resurrection, the first fruits resurrection, the first Sunday after the Passover, just as you prescribed for the children of Israel to celebrate as in Leviticus 23. We thank you for that amazing event, the event that changed everything, the event that made our faith what it is, without which our faith would be actually empty. So now we ask that by your grace, you will allow us to bring forth this message of the importance of the resurrection 2,000 years ago. We thank you and we bless you, and it is in the name of the resurrected Messiah of Israel and the Savior of the world we pray. Amen. So here we are sitting next to a replica that as of now, as you can see, has a closed tomb. Think about it. It has a closed tomb because it's not yet Sunday morning. It's not yet the time for that prophecy to be fulfilled. It's not yet the time for death to be defeated. And of course, in a few hours, 2,000 years ago, we all know that Mary left the rest of the disciples. It was still dark, and she made her way outside of the walls to where he was buried, and she found that the tomb was empty, and that the stone was actually rolled all the way aside. And it's very interesting because the story of the resurrection can be found, obviously, in all the gospel. Allow me to read it from Luke chapter 24, the first 12 verses. So here we are, Luke 24. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared, but they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. And then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Who do you seek the living? Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee," they said, "saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.'" And they remembered his words. And then they returned from the tomb and told all the things to the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other woman with them who told these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales. And they did not believe them. But Peter arose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. Amazing. You see, the disciples heard about it, yet did not believe that it's going to happen. They were shocked. The Bible said they were perplexed. And even Peter, who saw with his very eyes, because he did not believe the words of the women, and even Peter himself, he was wondering, he was marveling, and he still did not really understand what really happened. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the day that literally changed history. This is the day that all of our faith is on it. And make no mistake, Jesus appeared alive to more than 500 people on 12 separate occasions, all but one of the occasions, which is the one he appeared before Paul himself, occurred within the first 40 days following his crucifixion and resurrection. There is absolutely no doubt. There is no doubt that he was resurrected, because it wasn't just one person who saw him. It wasn't just two or three. You're talking about hundreds of people, and you're talking about multiple times and multiple places. And by the way, these were recorded events, such that, by the way, could not even be denied by Josephus Flavius, the Jewish historian himself of the first century. Now, Why don't we go back to the time of the creation and try and understand? We all know that Psalm 72 says that before the sun was, his name was already there. Yinon Shmo, Lifne Shemesh Yinon Shmo. The Messiah was there before the sun was created. The sun and the moon, they were created on the fourth day. He was there before. He was there before the creation because he was not part of the creation. He's not a created being. He's part of the Godhead himself. And we know that when God created Adam and then from him Eve, there was still no death in this world. Man was not meant to die originally. God saw him and he says, it's good. And it was perfect. You know, chapter 2 of Genesis is amazing. You can see how there was such an amazing presence of God with men, and he created everything, and he named everyone, and he gave men dominion over all the animals. And it was amazing. You know, death came only as a result of sin. When sin came to the world, death entered the world. Death was there by which, or by ways of God telling Adam and Eve not to eat from the fruit of that tree, or else they will die. Or else they will die. In other words, if you will not eat from it, you will not die. And guess who is the one who told them, hey, don't worry, you can eat and still not die. And of course, that rebellion that started then in chapter 3 can tell you that originally Adam was supposed to be immortal, and that Genesis chapter 3 brought death, and thus he is now mortal. Now we have expiration date to everyone. I mean, at first it was hundreds of years of age, and it went all the way down to today. If somebody crosses the 100 years old, this is an amazing thing. Although our medicine and our technology is so amazing, yes, we managed to bring it up from 30, 40, 50 back to maybe 80, but we're still mortal people. This body, as Paul says, is still a tent. It's not a building. And we definitely need a new one if we want to go to eternity. Now, remember, death entered as man fell. The fall of man brought death to the world. And it's a very interesting thing, because I'm thinking about that. Jesus being part of the creator and not of the creation obviously was immortal. Obviously, there was no expiration date. There was no death involved in all of that. But yet, God became flesh and dwelled among us. And we beheld his glory, the Bible says. That word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. Remember that. And the Word became flesh, and he dwelt among us. And the moment it became flesh, it became mortal. In other words, it will now die. It can die. And that death is quite interesting, if you really think about it. Because the death of him is a ransom for men. It's not death because of sin. It's death for the sake of others' sins. And that is a different thing. And of course, we have to remember, the Bible says that the resurrection is something that gives you the power of endless life. In other words, when he resurrected back to where he was, there is endless life. And with endless life, there is power. Death is no longer hanging. Death is no longer threatening. Death has been defeated. The power of the endless life. So Jesus, of course, as I said, from mortal to immortal. And then now, the resurrection is now giving us the validity that he, by his atoning death, is giving us the ability to move back to the original intention that God had for men, which is with eternal life. Now, I would like to address two deceptions that we can see in so many Christian circles and non-Christian circles as well that refer to Jesus in their either writing or in their belief. The first one is that Jesus is not part of the God. He's not God. I mean, the deity of Christ is being denied even by the Jehovah Witnesses. Every place in the scriptures where the Bible talks about his deity is being taken out of this. And so, you know, that's one deception. And by the way, when you say that, you take away his immortality. And it's interesting, the second one is Jesus never resurrected. There's so many people. There's so many, by the way, including most of the Jewish people today. They think, they know, I mean, it's a historical fact that Jesus was born and Jesus was here and Jesus taught. And nobody says he never existed. But I don't know that many Jewish people here that are not followers of Christ that will tell you that they believe that he actually did resurrect from the dead. So there's two things. Some people deny his deity and some people deny his resurrection. And it's interesting because these two things are everything that makes him so amazing and different. Everything that gives you that hope. Because think about it. If he is not part of God and if he never resurrected, then remember we just talked about a few minutes ago that there is no hope and there is fear and there is absolutely despair, agony, and death. And that's what this world probably would be in if we didn't have the resurrection. It's interesting because the resurrection is all across the gospel as one of the most important things that people must know. It's like it's easy to prove that Jesus existed and Jesus taught and Jesus had all, even crucified, you know, even in the Roman literature you would see that. But the fact that he resurrected changed everything, and that is what the gospel and the epistles are trying to communicate so many, many ways and times. So the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12 to 20, now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen, obviously. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. And then also those who have fallen asleep, those who died in Christ, have perished. And if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. But now, he says, look, your entire faith is based on it. Look, if it didn't happen, we're wasting our time preaching to you. We're wasting our time traveling, giving you hope, healing, preaching, teaching, ministering, praying for you. It's worth nothing. If this is just something temporary for the first century, then that's it. That's not what it's all about. Now, he says, Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. And not only that, the disciples and the apostles testified of it. And by the way, to be an apostle, you needed to be a witness of his resurrection, of his resurrected body. You needed to be someone who knew Jesus, who saw Jesus, and who can testify of all of this personally. And by the way, Christ himself, Jesus predicted his resurrection. It wasn't something that he kept hidden from his disciples. We need to remember that. I'm looking at what he said in Matthew 16, verse 4. He says, a wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And he left them and departed. The sign of Jonah of 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the fish. And it's very interesting, Matthew 16, 21, from that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. This is, by the way, in Caesarea Philippi. This is seconds after Peter is rebuking him for saying, I mean, Peter just seconds ago admitted and confessed that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus is saying, yes, you know, flesh and blood did not reveal that to you, but my Father which is in heaven. You heard right. I am who you just said that I am. But I want you to understand what Christ, by the way, is Messiah in Hebrew. Christos in Greek is Messiah in Hebrew. It says the Messiah is not a man. It's not somebody who's going to be born from just a regular woman who will be a nice man. And then at some age, you know, he's going to bring peace and prosperity and he'll die. No, it's the Son of God, God in the flesh. And by the way, in his first coming, he has to suffer. He has to be killed. And he will be raised on the third day. In other words, he said to them what is super hard for most people to understand. Can God sacrifice his only begotten son? Will he? And why should he? Why was it so important and so, I would say, necessary for him? Look, he says he didn't leave them with the sad news that he's only going to die. He said he will be raised on the third day. John 12, but Jesus answered them and saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. You know, it's amazing. You know, we found even a date pit from 2,000 years ago in Masada, and we planted it, ladies and gentlemen, and it now bears, there is a new tree from that which fell on the ground, that we found on the ground. There is life in it, but it had to die first. And he is producing, as you can see, much life. He's speaking. The problem, you know, I'm thinking about the disciples. How many times did Jesus speak to them? And he told them everything in details. The question is not if he said, the question, do you listen? How many things are written here? Do people listen? Do we read? Do we hear? Do we listen to what he says? Because if we listen to what he says, not only that we know that he resurrected, but we also know that that resurrection was the most important thing, because as a resurrected Lord, now we can be raised also from the dead. First from the spiritual death, and of course later on, we're going to get to it, we're going to see there is a physical resurrection as well. Now, even though the disciples were with him, physically, the disciples did not believe. Because Jewish people 2,000 years ago were not raised to think that God will send his son to be the appointed Messiah and to die. Look, the disciples, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, riding that donkey, fulfilling Zechariah chapter 9, the disciples thought, oh, look at this. Here he is coming. Here he's going to kick the Romans out of here. He's going to probably proclaim the kingdom, the messianic kingdom. He's going to do great. And guess what? Not only that he stopped and he wept over Jerusalem, but then he got off that donkey and he went and he turned those tables of the money changers. And I mean, he could see that religion blinds the people. Blinds them so much so that they don't understand the Word of God, although it is written. It is in the Scriptures. But they just follow traditions and rabbinical teachings, and they follow all of those expectations that they mix the first with the second coming, and they by doing so, they just remove the need for him to die, because they don't think that they need any death, atoning death of him for their sins. You see, in the mindset of the Jewish people 2,000 years ago, Messiah is to come to establish kingdom, and the biggest problem is not their own sins, it's the Romans. The biggest problem is not their own sins, it's the foreign occupation of the land. They did not believe, even though they followed him for 3 years, every single day, and he said it so many times, they still did not believe. That is why Peter was perplexed, and he was just amazed and wondered, what is it that I have just seen when the tomb was empty? In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You see, they did not have faith. They did not have faith. They thought, well, we see him. That's it. He's with us. And when he died, they mourned and cried. And they thought, that's it. He's gone. Even after the resurrection, they did not really believe he did resurrect. The two disciples that walked from Jerusalem all the way to Emmaus, and by the way, I'm just a mile and a half away from the road to Emmaus. They must have passed right behind me in this area. And they were sad and embarrassed and angry and so I guess depressed. Why? Because the one that they put their hope in, the one that they followed for the last 3 years, the one that they were sure is going to save Israel from Rome, just was hanging on the tree like the last criminal. And he was abused, and he was ridiculed and embarrassed and humiliated. And then he was just taken from that tree and was put in the tomb, and the tomb was sealed. That's it. If there was a hope that he will survive the crucifixion, now we know he's dead. And now we know he's, and if it's not enough, he's been dead for a day and two and three. And yes, we heard that some women went to the tomb. And yes, we heard that they said that he resurrected, but that's it. They did not believe. Luke 24, 44, he said to them, these are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written. Written where? In the New Testament? No. You know, people don't believe me. I became a believer in Yeshua, in the Messiah, without even reading a single verse in the New Testament. I didn't have to. Look what he said. He said, the words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written where? In the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. He did not say in the gospel or in the apostles, in the epistles, no, or in Revelation. These books were not even written yet. Quite interesting. And so we know that he was right, because he was all over in the book of Moses. You know, I can tell you, just Genesis 1, the true light of the world was the Messiah. Where was the light of the world coming from? If the sun and the moon and the stars were created on the fourth day, how come there was a light on the first day when God said, let there be light? Who was the light? Not only that, I mean, you can go on, and that's why Psalm 72 says, Lifnei Shemesh Yinon Shmo, before the sun was, his name was already there. Jesus is also, you know, you can find him all throughout the book of Psalms. I can give you 16 messianic psalms, which are the blueprint of salvation. I'm not even going to the New Testament to try to prove you that he was the Messiah. You can go to those Psalms, and they're everywhere from the very beginning to the very end. The blueprint of
our salvation. What about the books of the prophet? Are you kidding me? This is how I came to faith, through the prophet Isaiah. Chapter 53 changed my entire life. Isaiah and Jeremiah and Zechariah and Hosea, Daniel, all of them. You said he spoke of the separation from God, that sin separated us from God. Spoke of the promised solution, about the New Testament. People don't believe me. The word in Hebrew for New Testament is Brit Chadasha. People don't believe me that the Brit Chadasha, the New Testament, is in the Old Testament. The prophet Jeremiah promised that God is going to give Israel and Judah Brit Chadasha, New Testament. And it's in the Old Testament that he promised that. He promised miraculous birth in Isaiah chapter 7. Behold, a virgin shall conceive. And a rejected first coming, Isaiah 53, the suffering of the Messiah, the sacrifice of the Messiah, and of course, the victorious even second coming of him. And by the way, it's a little different this year. We're a week after Passover began. Today, we're a week after. So the Christian calendar this year and the Jewish calendar this year do not really coincide, do not really come together. But I can tell you, folks, that I don't believe in Christian or Jewish calendar. I believe in biblical calendar. And the biblical calendar is telling us that there is the month of Nisan is the first month. And by the way, you know I'm outside by all of these bugs that are flying all around here. But I want you to know that the Bible says that Passover shall be celebrated, and the first Sunday after Passover is the first fruits. And isn't that interesting? If he was crucified either, Thursday or Friday, and by the way, I don't want to get into that because, again, the minute you get into where he was buried and when he was crucified, you are dragged to the place that takes away the emphasis of the resurrection itself. But I can tell you, that Sunday morning, when Mary came to that tomb, he was already resurrected. And as 1 Corinthians 15 says, he was the first fruit. Just like he was our Passover, now he is our first fruit. And all throughout the feast, he was the Passover, the unleavened bread, and the bread and the first fruits. And then the Holy Spirit will come for Pentecost. And we know that after the first four festivals, there is a gap. And then comes the autumn festivals. And that is, of course, the Feast of Trumpet, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Tabernacles. And these are those that will be fulfilled in his second coming. He is even in the feasts of Israel. The prophet Hosea. Chapter 5, verse 15 says, I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their offense. Then they will seek my face, and in their affliction, they will earnestly seek me. Hosea says that the Messiah will return back to earth, back to us, but only after Israel will acknowledge their sinful nature and accept him and actually invite him. And they will say, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. This is why Jesus himself said on Mount of Olives, you will not see me again, Jerusalem, until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosea chapter 6, verses 1 to 3. Come and let us return to the Lord, for he has torn, but he will heal us. He has stricken, but he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up. You see that even in the way that he himself was resurrected, on the third day, we will be healed and resurrected. And then look what he says. On the third day, he will raise us up that we may live in his sight. Let us know. Let us pursue the knowledge of the Lord. His going forth is established as the morning, and he will come to us like the rain, like the latter and former rain to the earth. Hosea chapter 13, I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. And then look what he says. O death, I will be your plagues. O grave, I will be your destruction. Pity is hidden from my eyes. In Isaiah chapter 25, look what the prophet Yeshayahu, Isaiah says. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. The rebuke of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. And I'm thinking about Lazarus' resurrection. Think about it. Look, Jesus was the first fruits of the resurrection. What does it mean? Anyone that was resurrected before him resurrected but died. Lazarus was resurrected, but he died. He's not with us today, is he? But when Jesus spoke at the resurrection of Lazarus, he said in John 11, he said to Martha and Mary, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Look what he says. I am the resurrection and the life, he said. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And then he asked her, do you believe this? Basically, he says, look, I'm going to die for your sake, but I'm the resurrection also. And then there is life, the power of endless life. And then for those who believe in me, even if they die, they're going to live again because they will be part of the resurrection. And there will be that generation, which I believe all of us live in, that there will be those that believe that still are not dead. I'm still alive. You're still alive if you're watching me right now. And he says, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. In other words, there's those who fell asleep in Christ who died. And there's those who will be alive at the time of that amazing rapture, which obviously will cancel death for those who are alive. And then he asked her, do you believe this? Martha, I just raised from the dead your brother. Look, I've got the power not only to give life, but to take life. And to take life, nobody takes my life from me, he said. I lay down my life and I can take it back. And that's, of course, an attribute only of God. And you know, I'm surrounded here by lots of Jewish people right now. I mean, this whole production team, it's all Jewish people here. And it's amazing because, you know, I'm thinking about it probably, you know, by the way, there's quite a few people here. And they're working very hard for the last few hours on setting this whole thing up. And probably I'm thinking to myself, they're, you know, scratching their head and they're saying, yeah, he's talking about the resurrection, but is that really something possible? I'm thinking about it. You know that the resurrection from the dead is a very Jewish thing. You know, there is three things that Jews are hoping for, is the rebuilding of the temple, the coming of the Messiah, and the resurrection from the dead. Every Orthodox Jew will tell you that. And it's interesting because in 1982, a book was written called A Jewish Perspective of the Resurrection of Jesus, on the resurrection of Jesus. By the way, it was written by Pinchas Lapid, a theologian. He was not a believer in Jesus. He never thought Jesus is his Messiah. He, by the way, when he was asked, he said he could be the Messiah of the Gentiles. It's very interesting because that Jewish theologian and historian wrote a book in which he says, look at me. He says, I have no doubt that Jesus was resurrected. And everybody were like almost shocked. What? You think Jesus was resurrected? And he says, I mean, why not? And then they ask him, can you please explain? And he gave them 4 points. The first one he said, by the way, resurrection is a Jewish doctrine. Why are you so, I mean, resurrection is Jewish. By the way, baptism is Jewish. Baptism is not Christian. Baptism in the ritual bath in the mikveh is being done every day by so many Jews. Of course, the one baptism, for just as a symbolic thing to show how we were buried with him and resurrected, Of course, that's something that we do now in remembrance, but baptism as a concept was Jewish, and resurrection from the dead is a very Jewish thing, or at least Jewish hope. But then he said something interesting. Pinchas Lapid said, none of the disciples or the women believed that Jesus would die. He said, this is not a cooked book. This is not something that, is trying to lead you all the way to the resurrection. No, actually, they did not believe. They did not believe that he would rise from the dead because they were stuck on what? They were stuck on the second coming attributes of him coming and ruling and reigning. And you know what? The first problem was he didn't come riding a horse. He came riding a donkey. Then he didn't come to conquer, but he actually stopped and wept. But then Pinchas Lapid went on. He says, look, I read the New Testament. The gospel accounts exhibit extreme honesty. In other words, Peter was perplexed. The two disciples that went to Emmaus, they were sad. There was no plot here to engineer your mind of anything. It displays and exhibit extreme honesty. In other words, if he resurrected, it must have happened. Why? And now comes the fourth point, the transformation of the band of disciples. Think about it, folks. Think about the end of the gospel and think about it, the beginning of the book of Acts. You see a defeated group of people versus a bold and lively group of people. You see people with no hope, people that are ashamed, people that are embarrassed, people that are angry, and they feel probably stupid. We've waited probably 3 years. We thought, look, the two disciples that went to Emmaus, we were hoping that he was going to redeem Israel. But then what? That transformation. I mean, look at the book of Acts and everything that happens right after that. Amazing transformation. You see, when they were in their religious mindset, they couldn't see him. When they finally had faith, A, because they saw him, but after he went up to heaven to be with the Father, now they just needed to to just believe that not only that he's alive, but he's coming back. Religion cannot save you. Actually, it can deceive you. It can deceive you to think that you're okay and therefore there is no need for that ransom death. There is no need for death there, so therefore there's no need for resurrection as well. You know, the book of Isaiah, chapter 1, hit me so hard when I came to faith, when I realized that God hates religion, that God says everything you celebrate, your Sabbath, your new moons, your festivals, I hate. Who said that? Yeshayahu, Isaiah, the prophet, to the people of Israel. He said, what you've turned that into is it's something that troubles me. So I cannot endure. On one hand, you do all your prayers and all your things. On the other hand, you're lying, you're deceiving, you're angry, you're murdering people with your tongue and maybe even with your hands. You have blood on your hands. He said, I cannot tolerate both. He says, you have to be washed. You have to be clean. How can you be washed? How can you be clean? How can your sin turn white when it is so, so red as crimson? How can it be white as snow if there is no redemptive atonement that took place? If there is no alternative and super, super, super precious blood that was shed on your behalf so you will not have to die for your sins. Remember that power of the resurrection. He says, he died and it's sad. But if it was the end, then we're no different than any other religion. The Muslims, they believe in Muhammad. Muhammad is dead. I mean, Buddhists believe in Buddha. Buddha is dead. I mean, all religions believe in some prophets or some leaders, but they're all dead. The power of the resurrection itself makes everything different, everything completely revolutionary. Philippians chapter 3 says, though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so, circumcised the 8th day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin. Paul is saying to the church in Philippi, I am a Jew. I was circumcised on the earth the 8th day. I'm from the tribe of from the tribes of Israel, from Benjamin, he says. I am a Hebrew of the Hebrews, he says. Concerning the law, I was a Pharisee, remember. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church. Paul, Shaul in Hebrew, he persecuted the church. And look what he says. He says, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, I was blameless. But what things were gained to me? These I have counted loss for Christ. You see, I thought I'm perfect. I'm a religious man. I can go and kill Christians if I should or if I can. But now my eyes were open to understand all these things were just a stumbling block. They were skubalon. Skubalon is in the Greek is manure. It's trash. He says, I've counted all of this loss for Christ. Yet, indeed, I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of the Messiah, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. That's the rubbish I talked about, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in him, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know him and what? And the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, he said, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press forward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Job, Iov in Hebrew, the oldest book in the Bible. For I know that my Redeemer lives. Ki yadati shemoshi'i chai, goali chai in Hebrew. Yadati ki goali chai. I know my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at the last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and know not other. How my heart yearns within me. He knows that his Redeemer lives. And all that he went through, he didn't hate God. He actually was yearning to meet his Messiah, his Redeemer. You see, there is a need for a new priesthood. There's no doubt about it. Religion is not the answer. Religion is the problem. Hebrews 7 says, now beyond all contradiction, and the lesser is blessed by the better. Here, mortal men receive tithes, but there he received them of whom it is witness that he lives. Even Levi, who receives tithes, paid tithes through Abraham, so to speak, for he was still in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. Therefore, if perfection were through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise according to the order of Melchizedek? Melchizedek was not from the line of the tribe of Levi. He's not from the family of Aaron the priest. And he's not called according to the order of Aaron, he said here. For the priesthood being changed, of necessity there is also a change of the law. For he of whom these things are spoken belonged to another tribe, tribe of Judah Jesus came from which no man has officiated at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord arose from Judah, of which tribe Moses spoke nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident if in the likeness of Melchizedek there arises another priest who has come not according to the law of the fleshy commandment, but according what? According to the power of an endless life. Endless life. For he testifies, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. For on the one hand, there is an annulling of the former commandment because of its weakness and unprofitableness. For the law made nothing perfect. On the other hand, there is the bringing in of a better hope through which we draw near to God. And it's because of the power of endless life. The book of Romans is the Magna Carta of the entire New Testament, of the entire gospel. And you would think that whatever is so central in that book is so important in our faith. And indeed, pure doctrine, that book. You know, Paul wrote to the Romans. He never met them before. He's never been to Rome before. While he was in Corinth, in Greece, he wrote to the church in Rome. And he wrote Romans, which is 16 chapters of pure doctrine. And in them you can see Romans 6:4, walk in the newness of life. He says, therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. He said, spiritually, we are being resurrected from the dead. Romans 6:9, death has no dominion. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more, death no longer has dominion over him. Romans 7, verse 4, bearing fruit to God. Therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law through the body of Christ, that you may be married to another, to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God. That resurrection is the key to be able to even bear fruit to God. Romans 8:11, life to our mortal body. But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one that raised him from the dead, that one, if it's him, if that spirit, the Holy Spirit is in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Romans 10, verse 9, the confession of our faith, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God, what? God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You see, it's so important that without confessing and believing in that resurrection, there is no salvation. There is no redemption. If he was in that tomb, and if we would have found bones, and that's it, the end of the story, there is no hope, there is no redemption, there is no salvation, there is nothing. And the Bible says about the promise, 2 Timothy chapter 2, that we shall reign with him. It says, this is faithful saying in chapter 2, verses 11 to 13, for if we died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remain faithful. He cannot deny himself. And remember, the first resurrection began with him who was the first fruits. But it has two parts. It has him, and then it has us. And remember that. Colossians chapter 2, you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him. There is the spiritual resurrection, and then there will be the physical one. He has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. For the Lord, and in 1 Thessalonians, now comes this physical resurrection. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with a voice of an archangel, and with a trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. And then we who are alive and remain. Remember, I am the resurrection and the life. He says, he who died will live again. And he who did not die, he who is still alive, will not die. He says, look, and the dead in Christ will rise first, then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up, harpazo in the Greek, caught up together with them in the cloud to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, he said, look, therefore, comfort one another with these words. And I'm telling you, we're in the midst of 2021. There is pandemic around the world. There are lockdowns around the world. There are harsh, restrictions around the world. The economy is suffering. Lunatics took over some governments, and it's the craziness of everything is so overwhelming. Yet he says, your comfort. And the way you need to comfort one another is by saying these words to one another. Remember, you may have been already raised from the dead spiritually, but there comes the second part, which is the physical resurrection. Hold on to it. Comfort one another with these words. And of course, in Revelation 20, blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power. Remember, it has to be very, very, very clear, ladies and gentlemen. There are two births, there are two lives, there are two deaths, and there are two resurrections. There is the birth from the flesh, and there is a birth from the spirit from above. And there is the life in the flesh, and there is the new life when you become a believer. And then there is the first death. All of us maybe go through that because we have mortal body. And then there is the second death. It's the final death of all who did not believe. And there is the first resurrection of Christ being the first fruit and us when the time comes. And the second resurrection is for the final judgment after the millennial kingdom, the great white throne of judgment. And so I want to encourage you as we come to the conclusion of this message right now. I want to encourage you. Yes, for many of you, everything that is going on around the world today may seem like the stone is still rolled and there is no hope and there is no future and there is just no light. But I want to encourage you. In Jerusalem, 14 kilometers away from here, this is less than 10 miles away from here. In Jerusalem, the tomb is empty. In Jerusalem, the stone is rolled back. In Jerusalem, we have a testimony of that power of endless life. In Jerusalem, we know that not only death was defeated, but then he will come back. And he will come back first in the air to take us to be with him. And then he will return to that city, which will then, after 7 years of terrible tribulation, then it will beg for him to come and say, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, and he will come and save them as he promised. And they looked at him whom they pierced in Zechariah 12. And of course, the Bible predicts those things. And everything is based and is around and it is glued to the resurrection. Without the resurrection, our faith is empty. Our hope is gone. Our life is almost pathetic, if you really think about it. What's the point of believing in a dead person who, by the way, said he is going to be resurrected and never did? But then thank you, Lord, that over 500 people saw him in so many different occasions. And when they wrote, what they wrote to all of us is with not just conviction and faith, but with the testimony, with their eye testimony, that he indeed is risen. And in few hours, as the sun will begin to rise in Asia, in Australia, New Zealand, Japan, and of course in more than a few hours when the sun will rise in the rest of the world, I want you to remember, he is risen. We do have hope. Our hope is in him who promised Israel and promised his disciples that he is not going anywhere. That he, in other words, he will come back. He will come back to his own. First to take his own, and after Israel repents throughout the tribulation, to even come and save them. Father, I thank you so much for this wonderful truth that the resurrection is just so vivid and true when we think of our life. When we see that in our very life, the first phase of the resurrection had begun already. We have been indeed where we were raised spiritually from that death that held us. And now we are waiting for that soon return of you to take us out of here. That wonderful, wonderful rapture of the believers to be with him. And of course, all of that is only because of the resurrection and that power of endless life that brought about a new priesthood and brought about a new system that pushed away religion and gave a place for faith. We thank you and we bless you. And I pray that everyone that is now going through hard times, especially in countries that went back to harsh lockdowns and all across the world, from Canada on the west, all the way to Western and Eastern Europe, all the way also to the Philippines and other places in Southeast Asia. Father, I pray that in the next 24 hours, people will receive so much hope and comfort and excitement from your word. That word that became flesh and came and dwelt among us. That word that death and the grave could not hold. That which defeated death so we can now have not only the spiritual resurrection, but await with wonderful, wonderful expectation to a physical one. We thank you and we bless you, and we do that in the wonderful and matchless name of Yeshua, our salvation. The one who defeated death, the one who is going to return and save us. We thank you and we bless you in his name. Amen. Thank you, folks. Thank you for being with us this evening from the hills of the tribe of Judah, less than 10 miles away from Jerusalem, from the empty tomb. I want to wish you a happy first fruits resurrection. I don't like to use the term Easter, that comes from Ishtar and Ashtaroth and the goddess of fertility and bunnies and eggs. I prefer the biblical term from Leviticus 23, first fruits. And indeed, he was the first fruits resurrection. So I wish you a wonderful first fruit resurrection Sunday. And God bless you all. And shalom from the hills of Jerusalem, from Israel. God bless you. Bye-bye.